Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I'm speaking with Wes Hall. Wes is the executive chairman of Kingsdale Advisors and the founder of BlackNorth Initiative, which is an organization that challenges senior business leaders to recognize the prevalence of anti-Black systemic racism in the workplace and pledge to end it. Wes, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me, Tamara.
So for people who don't know who Wes Hall is, let's talk a little bit about you, if you don't mind. I was reading about your childhood and the story of how you immigrated to Canada. So can you tell us a little bit about your story as a little boy?
Yeah, so I keep a picture of my desk that actually reminds me of the immigrant story. So when I'm on Bay Street in my office, it's actually prominently displayed in my office on Bay Street. Now that I'm working from home virtually, it's actually prominently displayed in my home office. And I'm going to actually, for those who are watching on YouTube, will get the privilege of actually seeing that image. So this is the image of, the tin shack that I grew up in Jamaica. That's me in the red, and my grandmother in the older lady, and those kids on the steps. I remember, if you look at the house, it's actually built on stilts, 5-foot stilts. And the reason why it was built on that was because of the fact that there would be floods. It would, have flooding all the time in that area. And the water would actually come right up to the veranda. And I remember being a child and my sitting on the veranda and my legs dangling in the water without a care in the world while my grandmother inside just freaking out that these kids are going to drown. And there'll be no help in sight waiting, coming to rescue us, right? And that's the tin shack, literally is a tin shack. I have 14 brothers and sisters. And I was fortunate enough that my dad left Jamaica in 1970 when I was 1 year old. And he came to Canada and he built a life for himself here in Canada. And when I was 16 years old, he applied for me. I came to Canada to live with him. And I kept this picture for two reasons prominently displayed. One is to never forget where I came from, number one. And number two is to honor Canada. Because really, you always hear about the American dream and stuff like that, where you can come to the US or Canada and be a success story from nothing. And that dream is fading rapidly for many people these days, right? You find that it's becoming a lot more difficult to be able to go from that existence to where I am today. And if you look in the dictionary of impossibility, quite frankly, you're probably going to see a picture of this house and a picture of my life now. That's an impossible journey. And the reason why I'm so passionate about having it prominently displayed is for people to recognize the fact that we are a society where people give the underprivileged an opportunity. And over the years, those opportunities are getting smaller and smaller. And I would like to go back to that time because I am a product of those people's generosity. And so when I came here at 16, it was just amazing. I came to live in Malvern, and Malvern is a place in Toronto, in Scarborough in particular, that is a very tough neighborhood, very tough. But to me, Malvern was paradise in comparison to where I came from. And I looked around me and I realized that even though there were gangs and there were people doing bad things, and I felt that I could not fail in this country. I just had the confidence that I couldn't fail. And I didn't. And I would like to give young people the same confidence that I had back then. I want to give them back that confidence today.
We all have dreams, right? And these, you mentioned, this is harder to do now, and it is. Like, let's take the pandemic out of it. I think it was even harder when there wasn't a pandemic. It's just gotten harder and harder and harder to do for that dream, that Canadian dream, that American dream, whatever that is. When you were a young boy, when you were 16 and you came to Canada, were people good to you? Was there, did you experience racism here in Canada? Did you experience racism in Jamaica?
Okay, so that's an interesting question about racism. Where in Jamaica? In Jamaica versus Canada. So I'll give you my first experience with racism. My very first. My grandmother lived in a part of Jamaica called St. Elizabeth. And St. Elizabeth is a parish, like a province of Ontario. It's a parish that the people there have, because there's a lot of interracial relationship that from Germany and Cuba and so on, the people there are light-skinned people. And so my grandfather, who was from St. Thomas, which where the maroon slaves are from, are dark-skinned people. And he met my grandmother in St. Elizabeth. And they fell in love. But my grandmother was a light-skinned woman. And as a result of that, her family disowned her as a result of falling in love with my grandfather. And in fact, the only person that continued to communicate with my grandmother was her brother. Her brother actually left St. Elizabeth to move with my grandfather and my grandmother to St. Thomas. And that's where he died. That's where my grandmother died. That's where my grandfather died. I've never met anyone else in my grandmother's family all the years, even when I became an adult, right? Because she was completely cut off from the family because of that. That's my first experience. So my first experience with racism was really in Jamaica among people that look more like me, right?
With your own family.
In my own family,
yeah,
quite
wow.
frankly. In my own family. And as a young child, I really didn't make the connection until later on. And, you know, my grandmother would tell the story and you hear that, you know, she doesn't, you know, it's only her and her brother Winston are the only two people, but she has this big family from St. Elizabeth and none would come over to see her and she wouldn't go there to see them, right? Wow. And so when I came to Canada, I didn't, you know, I say this to people and I actually mean it to be true. I didn't really recognize that I'm Black until well into my career. What does that mean? It meant that I didn't view it as an obstacle for me as I was climbing the corporate ladder. I started climbing the corporate ladder in Canada at the very bottom, literally at the bottom of the ladder in the mailroom. That's where I started. You can't get any more entry level than that in corporate Canada. And because of the generosity of so many people that did not look like me, that I was able to keep going one rung, the next to the next, all the way up to the very top of the ladder, which is where I'm considered to be by most today. But it's because of those people who saw something in me that I didn't see in myself that gave me an opportunity to prove it, to prove them right, not to prove them wrong. They didn't do it to say, I'm going to run an experiment to see if this Black kid is as smart as he think he is or as smart as we think he is. They saw something in me that they were impressed by and they just kept on giving me opportunities. And just like, you know, sports or hockey, if someone's giving you a free shot at goal, what are you going to do? You're going to take the shot, right? And you're going to make sure that you're going to score so that it can keep on giving you a shot at gold. And that's what happened to me all throughout my career until later on, I start to look around and I realized that, wait a minute here, there's not too many people that look like me in this room. In fact, I'm the only one. And as I progress and people start making statements and comments, you know, whether it be microaggression or otherwise, then I start to realize that there is a reason why, you know, I'm the only one in the room and it's not normal for me to be in the room. And then as a result of that, we start to go, how can we change a conversation to go back to what caused me to be in the room to begin with, which is the generosity and kindness of other people that didn't look like me.
Your climb, I guess I could call it, you started in the mailroom and then, you know, you later got a job as, I mean, not overnight, but you got a job later as VP of business development, yep. At a big firm, right? Was it all easy, Wes? Was everything easy for you? Did you just like glide up this corporate ladder with no problems?
Well, you know, life is not easy, right?
Yeah.
You know, when you become an entrepreneur, it's not easy. When you become successful, it's not easy staying successful either. It becomes actually harder. It's actually harder to stay successful than to climb the corporate ladder. It's a lot harder. Because when you're climbing, people may look at you and go, yeah, he's ambitious. And they may not, you know, they may take you for granted. And then once you got there and people realize, wait a minute here, he's here with us. Why is he here? How did he get here? We have to prevent him from going any further because he's going to eclipse us, right? That's the attitude for certain people have, right? So as a result of that, those people with that attitude now start to put obstacles in your way so that you don't go any further, right?
It's so interesting that you say that because I hear so many people say this. It's okay until a certain point, but then you can't go any further here. Like, you're not allowed to be better than us. You're not allowed to be better. And that goes for so many things. I feel it's a lot of people say it's a very Canadian way. We, you know, we'll build you up. And then when you get to this point, it's like, oh, no. We say no. You know, it's very interesting that you just said that.
And it's because at the end of the day, you know, people will appreciate your rise because they go, you know, but he's there and I'm here. Right. And they'll give you a lot of opportunities when you're down here and they're here. It's when you start to get up to that level is when the resistance starts. Mm-hmm. Because then all of a sudden, people start to go, he's going to go above me. And they don't realize that at the end of the day, I appreciate all the people that helped me along the way to get to here. And all those people, when I pass them, I always remember them. And I'm always eternally grateful for them. So if there's anything I could possibly do to help them to get here, I'm going to do it. You know, when I started Kingsdale, I remember one of the gentlemen that I was partnering with sat me down, a white man. I was 34 years old when I started Kingsdale. This man was in his mid-50s. And he sat me down and he said to me, Wes, I'm a rich man. And I want everyone that I'm around, that are working with me, that are partnering with me, to be as rich as me or richer. Because for him, he viewed that as something positive for him to be able to say, I took this person from mm-hmm. here, and they became even wealthier than me. That's a feather in his cap. Not a lot of people think like that, right? So when he sat me down and he told me that, all of a sudden, I don't have to look over my shoulders at him. I don't have to second guess advice that he would give me or decisions that would make together that he's not looking out for my interests. Because he told me when I had nothing, when I just got started, he said, I want you to be like me or better, right? And how many times do you hear that from people these days? Not too many. No. Not too many people can appreciate the fact that someone who they mentored at one point could actually be better than them.
Yeah. Yeah. So BlackNorth Initiative, this is something new that you've started. And how did this start for you? And tell me what BlackNorth Initiative is.
So I'll tell you. So it started for me, really, it came to in the forefront when George Floyd got murdered. So I was thinking about, you know, this issue of Black folks in Canada and how not to be the only one and how we can be more inclusive, in particular on Bay Street. And I started that back in 2018. When the George Floyd murder happened, I wasn't watching what was going on. I was busy managing my businesses. I was on the board. I'm on the board of Sick Kids Foundation. I'm on the board of Pathways to Education. I'm on the board of the Toronto International Film Festival. And here's COVID disrupting everything and everyone, all organizations. It's all hands on deck for every company that I was involved in. And then somebody came to me and said, have you seen the video? And I asked, what video? And because I thought it was, I said, yeah, it was the Ahmaud Arbery video when he was jogging through the neighborhood and he got shot by two average citizens. And said, no, there's one that's more egregious than that. And they said, look at the George Floyd video. And I looked at the video And I saw this police officer's, you know, this officer's knee and the man's neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. And it affected me profoundly to the fact, to the point where I dropped everything I was doing, literally dropped it. And I sent an email to all the organizations that I was a part of that I'm taking a mental week because of what I just saw. And I don't think people appreciate that, right? How could it have affected me so profoundly? And other people that didn't look like me, it didn't really affect them the same way because it happened to someone in my ethnic group. And I looked at what happened to him and I thought it could happen to me as well. See, George Floyd, if you look closely at the video, he was pulled out of a Mercedes-Benz, okay? And he was treated that way publicly. If somebody called 911 to my house and the police came into my house and I have the murder weapon, a weapon in my hand, my clothes dripped in blood, and there was a body on the ground with a bullet hole in it, and I have the gun in my hand, they would say you're presumed innocent until proven guilty, no matter what the evidence shows, right? I have to get my day in court, and they now read me my rights, and they would say you have the right to remain silent because anything you say can and will be used against you. You have the right to an attorney. He didn't get any of those things, and he was accused of passing off a $20 bill. And so when I saw, and you think about those instances, you go, that could have been me. So I sat here and I didn't know what to do. I wrote an op-ed in the Globe and Mail. And it was entitled, When I Look in the Mirror, I See George Floyd. And I talked about me living in this neighborhood, Rosedale, jogging through the neighborhood. And I saw a white woman fell in front of me. And I hesitated to help her because I didn't know if she was disoriented. And here I am going to help her and then she would be fighting me off. And then my white neighbors would see this black man fighting over with a white woman, call the police who was white. And then all of a sudden, I could be in handcuffs or would go to jail because I didn't have any identification with me. And because of the fact that there's not too many black people in this neighborhood, in fact, I'm the only black man that I know, I'm going to say, well, I live here. And exec, sure, whatever. We'll sort it out in the police station, sir. And so as a result of that, as a black person like me, why would I be thinking that way? So my neighbors start, when they saw the article, they start calling me and saying, what's going on? How can we help? How can we help? And I said, let's form this group called the Canadian Council of Business Leaders Against Anti-Black Systemic Racism. And let's form as many of us as possible to deal with this issue of systemic racism. And let's start at the top of the company and work our way down to see whether or not systemic barriers exist for our black employees. And then let's get into society and do the same in society. And so that's what we've done. And we have so far 450 plus companies that have CEOs that have signed it, some of the largest in the country, such as TELUS. And we want to change the conversation for Black and Indigenous people in this country.
What do you say to Canadians who say there is no such thing as systemic racism in Canada?
So I think the definition in their minds is that I am not a racist. And there's no systems that were put in place to prevent people from moving ahead because of their race. So that's the view, right? And the way that I look at it is, it's kind of like an old house. And I bought this house. The house was built in 1852 that I live in. When I came to look at it, the foundation was falling apart. The basement was moldy. The ceiling was leaking. It was a mess. But it looked really great from the outside, but it was a mess on the inside. And I have two choices. Either one, I can fix it, right? Or two, I can live in it. And just when I die, I hand it to my kids and they can fix it, right? Because it's a lot of work to fix it. I got to put money in it. I got to put time in it. It's just too much work. Plus, I wasn't the one who created that mess. I wasn't the one who caused the ceiling to leak and the foundation to be bad. It's other people who did that. So my kids are going to inherit it just the same way that I got it, right? But I didn't do that. I didn't do that. I put the time in. It took me 2.5 years. I put the time, energy, and money into it. And when I die, my kids are going to have a pretty decent house. So we inherited this broken system that has systemic barriers in it to prevent certain people from getting ahead. and to cause other people to advance. We didn't build it. We inherited it, right? And if we think, you know, usually when, if you have a Black friend and you hang out with that Black friend a lot, chances are you're going to look at this Black friend and go, I did not know that you were treated differently until I have you as a friend. My wife is white. And my wife said to me, if I wasn't married to a Black man, I would never know that systemic racism exists in Canada. Why would she say that? Because whenever we go, for example, to shop at a high-end jewelry store and we walk in separately, everybody's all over her and everybody ignores me. Whenever we go to buy a vehicle, a family vehicle together, and she's going in to pick out whatever one she wants, they're all over her and not me. Whenever we go to a restaurant, she's treated differently. Whenever we check into a hotel, she's treated differently. And she sees it time and time again, and she goes, that's how you know there's systemic racism. Mm-hmm. If you don't have people in your circle that are affected by these barriers, you would never know it exists. So for the people who say it doesn't exist in Canada, I appreciate what they're saying because of the fact that their circle does not include people like me. And what I ask them to do is to widen their circle. And then after widening their circle, ask themselves, is everyone treated in this country the same way I'm treated?
And we all know the answer.
We know the answer.
We do know the answer. One, I just love how you, the house, that is, that explanation right there is the simplest, easiest, we inherited this and it's our job. Well, I think it is. I don't want to leave my kids. I want, yeah. You know, it's, but not everybody feels the same way, Wes. I guess that's my point, right? Is like, how do we bring them in? How do we bring them into, do we just leave those people behind?
No, I don't think you're ever going to bring those people ahead because those people feel that something has been taken away from them and handed to somebody else, right? And if you, for example, McKinsey did a study that indicated that Hollywood loses $20 billion a year because of lack of diversity. $20 billion. Now, if you're a white actor in Hollywood, right, and now, you know, are you a producer, right? If you're an actor, you're going to go, well, you know, I'm getting a lot of gigs right now. I'm getting a lot of gigs. I'm good. But if you are a movie maker, a studio, and you realize that you're losing $20 billion a year, aren't you going to now say, wait a minute here, I'm not going to leave money on the table. I know the white actor is really, you know, he wants to keep it going, but if I expand the pie, we're going to make so much more money, right? So as a business person, the studio owner would say, I'm going to expand the pie. And all of a sudden, that white actor is not threatened because they're going to get roles and they're going to get, and the Black guy is going to get the role and the woman's going to get a role and the LGBTQ plus will get a role. And we're now going to have so much more opportunity for so many more people by being inclusive, right? And so what we're saying to folks is that we understand the rationale to be, I'm going to lose something. But if they think about it on the basis that the pie has been extended and expanded because of the fact that more people are now helping to create opportunities, there's more brain power at the table, then we're all going to be better off for it. Our society, Canada, will be a better place for it, right? And yes. So, you know, we're saying to folks, don't worry. For example, a few years ago, we had this diversity conversation. And we realized women were saying, we're educated. We went to university. We graduate like more than men, right? And we're not in the C-suite, we're not in the boardroom. And so they go, it's not because of the fact that we're not smart, and it's not because of the fact that we're not capable, it's because we're women. It's the only reason, it's because of our gender. Because of our gender, we're not allowed in the C-suite in the boardroom. So what happens? They named it. We're going to have a gender diversity discussion with you men, and we want to be in there, and we want to come in there because you're excluding us because of our gender. we have this situation today whereby Blacks and Indigenous aren't allowed in the same places. And we know 31% of Black women have a postgraduate degree or higher. We know that 7 in 10 Black people have post-secondary university education. Why aren't they allowed in the room? It's not because they're not capable. It's not because they're not graduating from university. It's because of their color. So we're saying to folks is that because of the fact that when the gender diversity conversation started, nobody said you're a misogynist. Nobody accused you of being a misogynist. They just said, okay, we understand why back then. Now we're going to move forward and let's change the conversation. The same thing we're saying right now, we're not saying people are racist for not allowing us. We're saying, okay, let's move on and figure out why we're not there and come up with a reason that's going to help us to be more inclusive and be there. Because we're capable, because we're qualified, and because we want to contribute to building that pie just like anybody else.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. I love it. So, you know, talking about BlackNorth Initiative, and how many companies did you say have signed on?
Over 450 so far.
Wow. In Canada?
Yeah, in Canada.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. $1.3 trillion in value.
Those companies represent. Yeah. Well, I mean, I want to let you know that on this podcast, TELUS, we like to give back. And I mean, you just mentioned trillions of dollars, but we would like to give $500 on your behalf to BlackNorth Initiative.
And we will take it.
Thank you. Yes, I'm glad.
Thank you so much.
You know, every little bit helps.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, it's important, right, for us to give back and help move forward, especially when the guests that I talk to are so passionate about. That's why we wanted to have you on, because, I mean, your story, your charisma is pretty hard to contain also in this podcast. And so I really appreciate your wise words and positivity, Wes, because a lot of times, you know, we forget that part of it, right? And we get caught up, especially on social media and stuff, we get caught up in the negative part of things. George Floyd fueled you. Mm-hmm. To create change.
70% of the police shootings in the city of Toronto are against civilian deaths are against Black people, right? So if we look at it and say, oh, it's a U.S. problem only, it's not really a U.S. problem only, right? It's all our problem and it exists everywhere. And when you think about, you know, George Floyd and really what happened again, it has to fuel this thing in you that it's infuriating. However, you can't remain in that spot. You can't remain in that spot, you know, and if you keep looking in the rearview mirror when you drive, you're going to crash. You have no option but to crash because you're not looking ahead. The rearview mirror is there for you to glance and for you to see what's going on behind you and not be ignorant as to what happened behind you, but to focus on the road, the journey ahead. So what we've done is to say our job is to start from here. We're not going to accuse people and say, hey, you didn't have a Black person in your boardroom, so we're going to, you know, wag our finger at you. You didn't. Now you know that you didn't. Now you have an idea as to why you may not have had them there. Now we have a clean slate moving forward. And how do we deal with things from here on in going ahead? You know, and we look for allies. Even though you're taught to hate somebody because of what they look like, you still have to be a human being when you see that a fellow human being is treated in a poor and underserved manner. And so when we look at, for example, the BlackNorth Initiative and the Blacks and Indigenous, and we look at how they're treated, 30.4% of the federal prison population are Indigenous people in this country. They represent 5% of the population. And we say, how could that be the case? Because when you walk down the street, you're not afraid of an Indigenous person when you see them coming towards you. But the prison stats suggest that you should be very afraid. Those are systemic problems. And once we recognize those things, we can either leave them as they are and say it's somebody else's problem to solve, or we can get together and figure out how we solve them. And it's just going to create a better society for us if we do that, right? So there's no anger involved in trying to change things. Right? You know, and my grandmother would always say, you catch more flies with sugar, right? And, you know, so we're using as much sugar as possible to get as many people wanting to do this work with us instead of alienating them from us.
I love it, Wes. Thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. I want people to know that you can find out more about BlackNorth Initiative at blacknorth.ca. You can also follow Wes Hall on Twitter at Wesley J. Hall. What does the J stand for?
Junior.
Junior, I love it. Wes, you're amazing. You are just, I've learned a lot from you in this conversation and I really appreciate it. Thank you so, so much. And thank you for everything you're doing.
Tamara, thank you very much. My pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.